Oh, this. I just wondered if it started raining or something. let's right go into it. To build my story is inspired by this notion of a metalog. A metalog is a word from that I got from Gregory Bateson, and it is a kind of dialogue in which a kind of conversation about a problematic subject, in which the participants not only discuss the problem, but the very structure of the conversation as a whole is also relevant to the same subject. So it, maybe it's a meta lecture, meta presentation, but. This is Nora Bateson, who will be here tomorrow, and Gregory engaging in a dialogue, which at the same time is a metalogue. So what I will share with you is maybe doesn't always make sense. I put things together that are maybe a bit uncommon to put together, but I hope that the structure in a way tells a bit about how the subject of my, or the theme of my presentation, how I approach that. This is the place where I lived for 6 years in Sweden, near Hellefors. If I would go in the area and make hikes, there were places that I kind of fell in love with, special places in the landscape that were very dear to me. If you would come to a certain place maybe 1 or 2 months later, it might look like this, some clear cuts that happened. And at some point this became very painful to me. I almost limited myself to come to these dear places out of fear that any moment it might be destroyed like this. Then, sometime later, I moved to Finland to do a PhD on art-based environmental education, and I met an art therapist, Mary Helga Mantere, and she stopped me right in my tracks, and she said, when I told this story, she said, Jan, don't let ever anything limit you or prevent you from being in this state of love, of loving somebody or something. But if you then lose it, go through a process of mourning, but love fully, live fully, and go through the mourning also as part of that. So that's, for me, kind of, yeah, the theme of this presentation. And I think much of our life today has to do with encountering paradoxes, how we deal with, how we live with paradoxes. A paradox is a basic part of life and of evolution, is again a few points of Bateson. A paradox is a contradiction in which you take sides, you take both sides. One half of the paradox proposes the other, and dwelling with paradoxes, riding with the dichotomy, is like embarking on a sort of voyage. You come out knowing something you didn't know before, something about the nature of where you are in the universe. This is the platypus, the ornithopithecus paradoxus, so the paradoxical animal that nobody could fit in any scheme. So going deeper into this paradox, tragic realism, is when we're alive today, we get, for example, this in the news, that an iceberg at the Larsen Sea Shelf was about to break in 2016, and then it broke the size of 2 times Gotland. It's these immense events that are, this is maybe very graphic, but it's hard to take in, as we all know, and it might come back to you in your dreams and nightmares. It's part of our reality, but maybe less obvious being on a place like this, and Adam was talking about this yesterday, Timothy Morton, with hyper-objects. Any conversation about the weather, the nice sunny days we have, is somehow sooner or later to bound up in a conversation about climate change. So this is the notion of hyper-objects. It's all over the place. So we are in a more than one sense staying with the trouble. We are living with the troubled times. Donna Haraway, who wrote this book, says he's very impatient with two common responses to the horrors of the Anthropocene. One is a comic phase in technofixes, that technology will come to our rescue. And the other is that a cynical position that the game is over, it's all too late anyway, as if these are the two options only. Another view, and we'll hear more about that later when she'll be on the Skype presentation, of Bernie Letzman. In her book, Environmental Melancholia, she talks, for example, about apathy. And very oddly, she says, from her experience from psychoanalysis, apathy is a miracle of protection also. It's a place where we can dwell when we're in utter fiasco. We can rest there until we can go elsewhere and do something else. And she says, humans do care. They have a capacity for profound reparation through accessing their creative engagement with the world. What people care for won't naturally, and this is the problem, translate into action. But people do have this creative capacity, and that's something I would like to underline. So a way of looking at global warming and how our response is, often it's talked about in terms of resilience, like this tree in the snowstorm that is able to fear back and maintain. It's a system's ability to absorb disturbances, adjusting its functioning in the process. Agility is something else maybe, and that is the ability to move quickly and easily and to remain calm and productive during changing times. This may actually, this is, I think, an interesting aspect of it, reduce the buffers that provided the safety net. When one's world is shaken, one may have a need for a clear sense of purpose. So you might, in some sense, profound sense, be too agile, too flexible, too much moving with. And then there's a third possibility, which I would call sagacity. And that is wisdom that is grounded in sense perceptions, and that allows keen discernment and sound judgment. It's also an accumulation of wisdom over time. So many of our responses are in the immediate here and now. There's a crisis and we immediately respond, and we don't bring about this wisdom, maybe of also older generations, what they bring to bear. And to me, this tragic realism of realizing what kind of times we're living in today has certain aspects which I find also interesting to pursue further. One is, for example, that tragedy can be seen as a form of vaccination. It's reminding us that we have the potential for the sickness. Even despair can contain seeds of hope. The clear-eyed determination to live anyway. Active hope takes courage. It may be directed toward a future goodness that transcends our current ability to understand what it is. We yet lack the appropriate concepts. And I think this, for me, is also very important that in the here and now, we may not be equipped yet to imagine a future that may be different because we are still in the old paradigm, so to speak. So this notion of, I think it was Martin Luther who said, if I would know that the world would end tomorrow, I would still plant my apple tree today. There's some basic truths in that. We don't yet understand what may be coming our way fully. This I got from a text on environmental education after sustainability from a Finnish researcher. So I go now a bit deeper into this notion of paradoxes, and I start with a double bind idea, again from Bateson. And I start with a story from Through the Looking Glass. It's the second book of Alice in Wonderland. And it is Gregory Bateson reading this part on the bread and butterfly out loud.
And the gnat is a still small voice explaining the insects of Through the Looking Glass Land to Alice. We don't have butterflies, we have bread and butterflies. And the bread and butterfly has wings of very thin slices of bread and butter, and a head made of a lump of sugar. Alice says, what does it live on? And that says, weak tea with cream in it. Alice saw a difficulty.
So she said, what happens if it can't find any? The gnat says, it dies. Alice says, that must happen rather often. The gnat says, it always happens. The double bind in which the bread and butterfly finds himself, namely that if he gets his food, his head dissolves in it. Therefore, his only hope of survival is not to find any food, but then he starves. And this is, you see, a formal double bind of the simplest kind.
So the bread and butterfly, in a very basic sense, finds himself in an impossible situation. And the point of Bateson of telling this story often is that evolution is often much like this, that we are faced, or species are faced, with impossibility of contradictory adaptation. That it doesn't die from not finding the tea, it doesn't die from dissolving the head in the tea itself. It dies for not being able to handle this situation. It's what Bateson calls a dirty trick that nature plays on us. It's a bit unfair. The more adapted we are, the less we are capable to be in a flexible state. And then he says, the double bind, this experience may actually promote creativity. You have to find your way out of it. Nora Bateson will be here tomorrow, says, a double bind is a pattern in which there seems to be no solution for escape. On the other side of it, there is another stage of wisdom. A double bind motivates evolution, finding a third alternative to survive. It's the creative imperative. It's the moment when, because this doesn't work, and that doesn't work, something else needs to be improvised. An example of this, of sort of this wisdom at the other side, is loving anger. This comes from researcher Jean Briggs, a Canadian researcher who worked with the Inuit people, the Kipi. And she came on this notion of loving anger, that a child might be approached with something called benevolent aggression. So a mother might say to the child, doesn't that taste good, and bite in the child's arm? Or it may say, wasn't that fun, and slap the child in the face? Of course, the child is in total confusion and disarray. But then after it, the mother reasserts the child and expresses her love, so that the insecurity, the feeling of not knowing what this meant, the double bind is taken away by this reassurance of love, so therefore the loving anger. And the point of Jean Briggs in analyzing this is a way of, in which this culture has made sense in a very harsh environment in which you'll be facing situations that you are alone and exposed. So what I'm interested in is this skill of what you might say mindful schizophrenia, of not running away from schizophrenia, not playing it down either, but to go right into it. I get inspiration from this quote of Waylon Jennings, a country singer. I've always been crazy, but it's kept me from going insane. It's like this image of Baron von Münchhausen, who's able to pull himself from the swamp by pulling his own hair. Two different voices operating at the same time is part of the paradox. Here I find that also in the music of Arvo Pärt.
Nähdä midagi rohkemat kui ainult need see must klahv ja see valge klahv siin. Aga edasi. Ja hoiastanud. See ei olegi nii tähtis, milline see viis siin täpselt on, aga see ühend selle kolmkõlaga, ta moodustab niisuguse valulise ühendi. Ja nagu hing tahakski laulda lõpmatult seda lihtsalt. Kuulake.
I like how he makes this sign of the fingers that the two are interlocked, the black and the white. Here's a part of an interview what Boeckel did with him.
Question and answer the different voices inside your music. It's almost like Pinocchio and little cricket and so one is like human and always doing mistake or pain or making pain to other, and the little cricket is more like comfort him or tell him, you know, do you feel it is inside your music, or maybe I imagine?
I'm very happy about that you talk about it. It's really so. And this new style, it consists two ways, two sides. So that one line is my sins, and another line is forgiveness to these sins. Mostly the music has two voices. One is more complicated and subjective, but another is very simple, clear, and objective. But
so for me, it's very interesting how he's able to integrate these two voices, the joyful sorrow, in one piece of music. So not choosing for the either or, but to live with both sides. Another way of approaching this idea of two voices I find in Joanna Macy, who developed this work that connects. It's about going right into the feelings of despair, not hiding away from it, and exploring what it means to feel the pain of living today. In a recent interview, she said, on one level, what I do is to help people to be better activists, more resilient, creative, responsible, and effective. But on a more ultimate level, I'm doing it so that when things fall apart, we don't turn on each other. If we are going to go out, then we can do it with some nobility, generosity, and beauty, so we do not fall into shock and fear. In an interview, she says a bit more about this.
I wish that I could tell people that it's going to be all right if they do this. But then I can't, of course. And then I think to myself, if I could, you know, I mean, if I could give a pill to you, and then you'd suddenly say, oh, it's going to be all right, everything's going to be fine. Would that really draw forth from you the full creativity and courage of which you are capable? Would it? So it's that knife edge of uncertainty that keeps us awake.
So that knife edge of uncertainty, that's something I want to stay with. That she on one side works to avert that we turn on each other, and at the same time to see the crisis as opportunity for creativity. Going to pieces can open us up to new perceptions and responses, staying with the trouble. Where does art come in this? Many ways, I think, but I think the first way to think about art is to move away from encountering art in a museum. I mean, that's one way of approaching art. But to look at art as a way of doing, a way of being in the world. It's maybe some of it is about getting lost, which I get from this book of Rebecca Solnit. It's to be lost is to be fully present, and to be fully present is to be capable of being in uncertainty and mystery. The job of artists is to open doors and to invite in the unknown, the unfamiliar. And this is again such a paradox. To calculate on the unforeseen is perhaps exactly the paradoxical operation that life most requires of us. Joseph Beuys, the artist, was once asked by an interviewer, why is it that you always wear gray clothes and not much color? And he said, no one asked whether I might not be interested in evoking the whole world of color in people as counterimage, to provoke in them a world of light, a supersensible spiritual world through something that looks quite different. One can only create after images by not doing what is already there. And to me, this is key, not doing what is already there, to improvise with the situation in new ways and to evoke something that is not yet present. For example, in the art activities course that I do, sometimes I will go and start with a group painting at this moment of day when the sun is disappearing. And then you have to lose control. You cannot see all the colors on your palette anymore. You have to surrender. A little bit about how to understand this maybe more is this notion of a grammar of fantasy. This is from the Everglades. There's a story of in this book of Walker Percy. When he was a young boy, he went there with a guide into this Everglades and saw this bird. And then the guy told him, it's the blue dollar hawk. And then he came back home later. As a boy, he liked his name. And then his father said, yeah, it's not a blue dollar hawk. It's actually the blue darter, the Cooper's hawk. And then he was very disappointed. He much more liked the notion of the blue dollar hawk. And then Walker Percy says that often the wrongness of the metaphor seems the very reason for its beauty. Beauty seems proportionate to its wrongness or outlandishness. So you're really pushed, shaken in another way, and this evokes something else. And Gianni Rodari, who wrote his book, The Grammar of Fantasy, he inspired Reggio Emilia pedagogy. It says, one electrical pole is not enough to cause a spark, it takes two. The single word acts only when it encounters a second that provokes it and compels it to leave the track of habit and to discover new possibilities of meaning. In the fantastic binominal, the words are not taken in their daily meaning, but freed from the verbal chains. They are estranged, shifted, thrown against one another in a sky that has never been seen before. Like, for example, combining dollar and birds. That does something with your imagination. The mind is born out of struggle, he says, not out of tranquility. So my last part is the distance to beauty, as I think is very connected to this notion of art. And I had this experience of meeting Sarah, who's an art teacher on the Åland Islands. And she told about an experience when she was working with the youngsters. And at one point, one of the youngsters sighed and said, I'm so tired of saving the world. Can't we do something else for a change? In the classes, there has been one environmental problem after the other that we have tried to understand and come up with solution for. Too many crises. And I see that the disasters that our civilization has built up are now thrown into the arms of the new generation. So it rolls over them in every media. It probably just makes them numb. And then she says that she wants to reconnect with beauty. Philosopher Arne Naess developed something which he called beautiful actions and moral actions. A moral action is that you do something that you need to do to overcome, for example, the ecological crisis. But it's often by telling other people how they ought to live, how they ought to behave. It's with the finger. You should do this, you should not do that. That's a moral action. A beautiful action is actually the same thing, that you do what is necessary to overcome the ecological crisis, for example. But you don't do it because anybody tells you how you should be doing, but it is a beautiful action because it follows from your inner voice. It feels natural to do what is just, and therefore it's beautiful. So, for example, if you're out camping in a place like this, nobody needs to tell you, clean your rubbish after you. You clean up your own rubbish with joy because it feels appropriate, and that makes the cleaning up a beautiful action. And Arne Naess would encourage the environmental movement to move more into the direction of developing beautiful actions. The same ideas of the Antoine d'Exupéry, who wrote The Little Prince. He wrote another text about building ships. And he said, if you want people to build ships, don't drum up people to collect wood and don't assign them tasks and work, but rather teach them to long for the endless immensity of the sea. So it's a totally different approach to the activity of building ships or fighting the ecological crisis. Make people dream, make them long to be somewhere else. And James Hillman, the psychologist, says this, I think, very nicely. I'll read it out loud. We must first be moved by beauty, he says, for then love is aroused. When you love something, then you want it near, not to be harmed. What evokes love? As has been said in many places and felt by any one of us, it's beauty. Beauty astounds and pulls the heart's focus towards the object, out of ourselves, out of this human-centered insanity toward wanting to keep the cosmos there for another spring and another morning. This is the ecological emotion, and it is aesthetic and political at once. So it's maybe a bit uncommon in the context of political struggles to talk about love and to give it a central position.
It is hard going, and it is cold sometimes on the hands, and I do get up very early. And all that effort is ultimately going into trying to make something that it is effortless. I wish I'd reached this point about an hour ago, before the sun had risen. What is extraordinary that I didn't expect, but I could only have dreamt of happening, is that the sun coming from there shines completely on both sides of the rock. So all the icicle is illuminated against that cliff, and I never had any idea that would happen. So the potential here is fantastic. And there's so many works that I've made that the very thing that brings the work to life is the thing that will cause its death.
So to me, this is actually a profound statement. The very thing that brings the work to life, the sun, is the thing that will cause its death. To me, it's also embracing the paradox of living today. That's it. Thank you.